We've seen some scenarios and how we can diagnose some common performance issues. Now, Bob, you know, once we know what our issue is, what are some specific things we should consider doing in order to tune or accelerate the perf that we're getting?
Yeah, thanks, Anna. Certainly some things to consider that are specific to Azure SQL, but feel a little bit like SQL Server. So first of all, you might want to scale CPU capacity. Now, how are you going to do that on your deployment today? Well, if you're running a bare metal machine, you got to get another machine and you got to migrate your database in SQL Server. In virtual machine environments, often you can stop the virtual machine and change your CPU configuration to get more CPUs. But what if you don't have enough capacity? Again, you might have to actually migrate your database, not in Azure SQL. We're going to provide you portal, T-SQL, and CLI capabilities to literally scale the number of CPUs up or down for your scenario that you need to meet your CPU demands. Hyperscale is really interesting because it does it in constant time. And in either case, you're going to experience a small set of downtime to do this, but depending on how you're trying to scale your operations, this downtime can be actually quite small. And even things like serverless provide auto scaling of these environments. Now, IO performance is interesting. And we often talk in terms of IOPS or IOPS or IO per second. And I found a lot of people in SQL Server environments really aren't even measuring that today. So make sure you understand how to measure IOPS per second, even things like Windows Performance Monitor in your own environment. You can measure IOPS with our DMVs and metrics we provide in Azure SQL. So IOPS restrictions are dependent on your deployment option, your service tier, your vCore model. We have those documented on what IOPS we support. You'll have to go look for the max IOPS that for your particular deployment, and that can show up in the form of longer IO waits. So you need to kind of take a look at if you're getting longer IO waits, could it be you're actually restricted by IOPS? But again, our DMVs show you how to go look at those kind of things. And you can scale up and change to either business critical or even sometimes number of vCores to gain higher IOP performance. So for faster IO latency issues, you might consider things like business critical or hyperscale. They're going to be more, I'm going to give you that higher or better or lower IO latencies or better IO performance in your deployments. For faster IO latency for managed instance, though, it's really about business critical, but specifically for managed instance, it could be the number of files or the size of your files that could increase IO performance for you. And then, I don't know if you've been using SQL for a while, but a lot of times just batching your transactions together instead of what we call singleton transactions can improve IO latency scenarios, and that's even applicable to your SQL Server deployments. But sometimes I've seen people move from an on-premises deployment to an Azure SQL and maybe pick a lower storage tier, and then this kind of type problem will crop up. So that's more of an application change that can actually improve your performance. Now, memory and workers are interesting. So for Azure database, scaling up your vCores will give you higher limits for memories and more concurrent workers. For managed instance, it's scaling up vCores to get that more memory capabilities. Keep in mind that if you're using in-memory LTP, it could be using a portion of that memory for business critical tier scenarios. And also keep in mind, as I've talked about in previous videos, that we use Windows jobs to limit those memory constraints. So you might be looking at some of the DMV that's going to show you the overall memory of, say, the virtual machine behind the scenes, and we're not maybe going to give you all of that capacity because of the memory limits we've documented per your service tier, and that using things like DMOS job objects can show you that true memory capacity of the SQL deployment you're doing in Azure SQL. And then in managed instance today, you can actually change max worker threads. I should caution you that we're taking a look at that. It's possible we may actually throttle max worker threads in a managed instance environment because we found some customers are just bumping up this number and running into problems in our deployment. So today, you can change that, but that is something in the future we're considering limit, just like we do in Azure database. And then finally, for application latency, you know, Anna's mentioned before from a network connectivity point of view to use redirect connections and not proxy. That's going to give you your best application latency performance. But I've often found that some customers are used to their environment of building applications that are what we call chatty. In other words, they're sending a lot of traffic back and forth and not taking advantage of things like stored procedures or limiting their result sets. And when they get into an Azure environment, even when everything's deployed in Azure, they're running into some latency issues they would not see in their on-premises deployment. So make sure you take a look at your application. And often, you know, if you're migrating, say, from SQL Server, this is an opportunity for you to go ahead and optimize these chatty application scenarios. So I've shown you CPU, IO, memory, application latencies, things that are somewhat specific to Azure, but a little bit like your SQL Server deployment. But don't forget that tuning your SQL queries, just like a SQL Server in Azure SQL, is really important. getting the right indexes, batching applications, batching queries, using stored procedures, parameterizing queries correctly, and properly processing result sets. Those kind of type things I've seen across the years in SQL Server cause customer performance pains. They are no different in Azure SQL. So just keep in mind, your standard SQL query tuning opportunities and activities are still going to be important to achieve the best performance you can get from your Azure SQL deployment.
So thanks, Bob. We've seen some new things that we can consider, but you know, I also really like the call out at the end is that at the end of the day, it is just SQL. So you're going to have to leverage the existing skills that you have in Azure as well. Tune in for the next video.